We're talking about responses to acute exercise. We're talking about musculoskeletal response, increased blood supply, increasing muscle pliability, range of movement, and muscle fibrators. Firstly, increased blood supply occurred due to increasing demand for oxygen and an increase in metabolic activity when exercised. By increasing the blood supply, this will deliver great amounts of oxygen to the muscles as the heart pumps blood quicker around the body. This means that an athlete can last longer when taking part in the exercise. Muscle pliability. Muscles become more pliable when they become warm. This helps to reduce the risk of an injury. This is because during exercise, the muscles contract quickly. The fast contractions generate heat, which make muscles more pliable. Changes of endurance occur during exercise because synovial fluid is secreted as a result of joint movement. During exercise, synovial fluid becomes less viscous and therefore the range of movement at the joint will increase. Exercise increases your range of motion because they stretch out the muscles. As you carry out the exercise, the muscles will begin to extend more, which will allow the joint to be able to move further. Muscle fibre tears. Tiny tears occur in muscles when they are put under pressure whilst exercising. These micro tears in the muscle tissue cause swelling, which puts pressure on the nerve ending, which results in pain. To strengthen muscles, you can use specific training. However, the body must rest to repair the micro tears and refuel before training. Energy systems response to acute exercise. The phosphorylated system is the immediate energy system used when activities are at high intensity. Oxygen is usually not used in the system. The energy used is found in the muscles and the liver. Creatine phosphate has a high energy bond. When this bond is broken, energy is released. This energy is used to resynthesize ATP from ADP. The energy released in this system can almost immediately be replaced. Therefore, several short bursts of activity can be repaired without the body becoming fatigued. The lactic acid system is a short-term energy system that is used when energy is required for a long period of time at high intensity. But because it is without oxygen, it's not sustainable over a long duration. The system works by converting the pyruvate produced from the glycolysis of glucose into lactate, converted by the enzyme lactate. The ATP allows exercise at high intensity to continue up in the muscle to the point that the lactate reacts on toxic levels where the muscle will start to fatigue. The aerobic system is a long-term energy system which requires oxygen. The system occurs in the mitochondria, which converts food into energy. Glycolysis, the Krebs cycle, and the electron transport chain make up metabolic reactions called aerobic respiration. The disadvantage is that it takes a long time to do this. It takes a longer time for the heart to deliver oxygenated blood to work in muscles, therefore the aerobic system is slower than the other energy systems. Energy continuum. Energy is gained through food, mainly carbohydrates and fats. The energy is transferred from the food into the proteins in the muscle. ATP is a supply of energy to the body. It's a molecule that stores and releases chemical energy to be used in the cells. When a bond is made between ATP and another phosphate, energy is stored, which can then be used at a later stage. Heart rate anticipated response. Before exercise, your heart rate picks up as a result of anticipated heart rate response. When the brain thinks about exercise before it actually starts exercising, the nerves that release the chemicals adjust your heart rate, increase the heart rate. This is because the body anticipates exercise, so prepares for the activity, increasing the amount of oxygen being delivered to the muscles so that they have a good supply of oxygen for when they begin exercising. The rate that the heart reaches for the start of exercise is the anticipated heart rate. Activity response. It is quite similar to the heart rate anticipate a response. I start the exercise, the nerves in the brain detect cardiovascular activity. They then send out chemical signals to increase the heart rate as well as the strength by which the heart is pumping. This means that more blood, which carries oxygen and fluid to the exercising muscles at a quicker rate. Blood flow is also altered to meet the correct proportion gain. This means that some areas will have a higher blood flow if they're exercising, such as the biceps, in comparison to areas that are not exercising, so they therefore require less blood to protect the liver. Increased blood pressure. Blood pressure is the pressure of blood against the walls of the arteries. There are two different types of blood pressure, systolic and diastolic. During exercise, both heart rate and blood pressure increase. However, there are mechanisms that prevent the blood pressure becoming too high and also bring it down. Both oxygen consumption and heart rate increase during aerobic exercise to reach the demands of the intense activity. This means that the pulse rate will rise and the blood flow to the muscle increases. Vasodilation. Thermoregulation is a process which regulates body temperature and is controlled by the cardiovascular system. The body temperature becomes too high. Blood vessels just under the surface of the skin dilate, which means that they increase in size. It's called vascular. Due to increased surface area, more heat can be transferred across the skin and out into the air. A lot of heat therefore cools the body down. Vasoconstriction. This is where if the body temperature comes too low, the vessels constrict, which means that they decrease in size. This means that less heat will be lost through transfer across the skin and into the air. There is a smaller surface area, therefore more heat remains in the body. The respiratory system's response to acute exercise. There is an increase in breathing rate. Pulmonary ventilation increases during exercise, which increases the depth and rate of breathing. This is regulated by the inspiratory center, which increases stimulation of the diaphragm and intercostal muscles. Also stimulates other muscles during inspiration, such like the pectoralis minor. This increases the force of contraction and therefore increases the depth of inspiration. The inspiratory center stimulates the expiratory muscles, which are the intercostal muscles, obliques and rectus abdominis. This causes a forced expiration, which reduces the duration of inspiration. In response to this, the inspiratory center stimulates the inspiratory muscles, causing them to inspire. This results in the intensity of the exercise increasing, the depth of breathing decreases, and the rate of breathing increases. There's an increase in tidal volume. Tidal volume is the amount of air inhaled and exhaled with each breath. The average is around 500 centimeter cubed. Tidal volume increases to around 3 to 4 liters during exercise. This increase occurs as the breathing rate increases to try and meet the oxygen demand for the respiring muscles. Increasing the tidal volume allows a greater intake of oxygen in the